On the mountain, in the valley, in the crowded streets, or the empty desert, in our hope, and in our waiting, we are never alone.
Praise the Lord. If you didn't know by now, I will start a new series working up towards Christmas now, and it's the God with us, Immanuel, and I'm excited about this. They may love Christmas season. Man, I'm telling you, I love it. I love it. I mean, some of you ought to be more excited about Christmas than that. It'll hit you. Some of you have been in Town East Mall shopping all weekend or something, you act like. I know it's tough out there, but that's why I use Amazon. I'm just saying. It's a little bit quicker and a little bit easier. I don't have to put up with the crowds. But if you could turn me down a little bit, Daxton, I've got a really strong muffle going on up here. I think they can hear me anyway. Can you hear me all right? All right. Isaiah chapter 7, verse 1 through 16 in your Bible. If you can find that, we'll be preaching out of Isaiah. We know that when we mention the God with us, we thank Immanuel, and the kids are going to be singing some Christmas carols, I think, starting next week. I'm excited about that. I'm ready to hear Immanuel, that famous Christmas carol that a lot of you have sang through the years. But you're able to stand with me for the reading of the Word of God. Isaiah chapter 7, good-looking crowd here this morning to worship the Lord, and I'm excited. Your worship excites me. Don't stop worshiping God. It excites me when you get excited. And the Bible says this in Isaiah chapter 7 and verse 1, "And it came to pass in the days of Ahaz, the son of Jotham, the son of Uzziah, the king of Judah, that Rezin, the king of Syria, and Pekah, the son of Remaliah, king of Israel, went up toward Jerusalem to war against it, but could not prevail against it. And it was told the house of David, saying, Syria is confederate with Ephraim, and his heart was moved in the heart of his people as the trees of the wood are moved with the wind." In other words, he was very anxious and scared. "Then said the Lord unto Isaiah, Go forth now to be Ahaz, thou and Shear Jashub, the son at the end of the conduit of the upper pool in the highway of the fuller's field." Some of your Bibles may say the washer's field, and they're both right. "And say unto him, Take heed and be quiet. Fear not, neither be faint-hearted for the two tails of these smoking firebrands, for the fierce anger of Rezin and Syria of the son of Remaliah. Because Syria, Ephraim, and the son of Remaliah have taken evil counsel against thee, saying, Let us go up against Judah and vex it, and let us make a breach therein for us, and set a king in the midst of it, even the son of Tabal. This saith the Lord God, It shall not stand, neither shall come to pass. For the head of Syria is Damascus, and the head of Damascus is Rezin. And within 65 years shall Ephraim be broken, that it may not be a people. And the head of Ephraim is Samaria, the head of Samaria is Rephaelah's son." And then circle this in your Bible, if you do mark in your Bible. "But if you will not believe, surely ye shall not be established. Moreover, the Lord spake again unto Ahaz, saying, Ask thee for a sign of the Lord God. Ask it either the depth or the height above. But Ahaz said, I will not ask, neither will I tempt the Lord. And he said, Hear ye now, O house of David. It is a small thing for you to weary men, but will you weary my God also? Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Immanuel." Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. And God, we thank you that you cared enough to come down from heaven and live with us, oh God. And God, you cared enough that, God, you put your son on a cross. And God, he was sacrificed for our sins. And God, you loved us enough that you didn't leave us living this life alone. But God, we have a friend that sticks closer than a brother. And God, thank you for the Holy Spirit we felt here this morning. And God, I pray today maybe someone walked into the house of God this morning. And God, and they are bound by their sins. And God, but you could transplant their heart. You can take a heart of stone and make it a heart of flesh. And God, we'll give you all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. May be seated. I was looking as I was reading this scripture and thinking about the new series, God With Us. There was so much I wanted to talk about and so much I wanted to share. It's kind of hard for me not just to jump to Luke chapter 2 and get to the Christmas story, but we're kind of building that up, and I'm going to try to save that to the end. I think I can make it. I don't know. I get pretty excited about stuff, but I have been trying to build this 4 weeks up. Some people call this Advent that would have started last week, and it's the Advent of working itself way up to Christmas. But I've never really done that before. As many of you know, just served here now. Well, we're coming up on 2 years now. But I haven't really had an opportunity to be able to preach that long about the same thing. I would more preach maybe once or twice a month as associate pastor. But I'm so excited about this idea of Immanuel, God with us. But whenever I typed in Immanuel, for a second I thought, wait a minute, I've spelled that wrong. That's not right. And me and my wife, we was having a discussion. I'm sorry if some of you knew this, but I knew they spelled it different ways because I see it on windows and I see it on stuff. But if you spelled it with an I, you're right. And if you spelled it with an E, you're right. Because if you spell it with an I, that's coming from the Hebrew text in English. And if you're spelling it with the E, then that's coming from the Greek or the Chaldee. But sometimes, really, the quickest translation of Immanuel is I-M-M-A-N-U-L. But also, it's not wrong. If you have a manger scene at home that says Immanuel with an E, that's okay too. But as I begin to think about this idea of the word itself, when you see the word Immanuel, the last part of the word is E-L. So that means God. And the first part of the word is I am, which means us. And in between means with us. So it is God with us. And I'm so glad that God cared enough to come down from the throne of heaven. I still get amazed at the idea of thinking God that breathed dust into my body cared enough to come down and to spend time with us. But here was Ahaz, the king of Judah, and Ahaz was anxious, the Bible says, in his heart as the trees were moved in the wind. But Ahaz had been through some stuff in life, and how many of you know life can shake your faith? We're not always up on the mountaintop. Sometimes we get down in the valley. And if you're honeymooning with Jesus, Terry Simmons, I'm happy about that. And I'll get up there with you honeymoon. I'll put my head up in the clouds with you. But every once in a while, some stuff happens. And Ahaz had experienced some stuff. So if I was going to title this message, I would title this message, The God of the Valley. Immanuel, God with us, the God of the Valley. And Ahaz found himself in the bottom of a valley. And as I read a lot of that stuff, I know it kind of you get lost in where it's at. So I want to kind of summarize that story for you. Isaiah was called by God to go to this man and give him a message of grace in the midst of his troubled life. But Ahaz had had about a few years before this, Ahaz had had an encounter with the Syrians. And Ahaz was real discouraged in his heart. And the Bible says that he was scared, that he trembled, that the hearts of him and all the people. Be careful how you act, because the people around you will be affected. Amen. Be careful. And Ahaz had been affected. This is a king of God's property. I mean, he's the king of Judah, and he's the southern kingdom. And he now has he has people that's coming against him that somehow the Syrians made a league at the same time to come with Israel, and they're going to destroy his city. And I don't know about you, but if they're outside knocking on my door with torches going to burn my house down, I get a little nervous too. That's why I keep a little something-something for surprise in case someone shows up. Someone might mess around my house, get lead poisoning. Amen. I would hate to do it, but I'm just being honest. I believe that that's part of our rights. Amen. To bear arms. So anyway, as I move forward, I'm thinking this dude's a little bit scared. He's beginning to tremble and think, man, this whole thing could come to an end. And Ahaz, but he had been defeated by the Syrians before. You know, the devil will come at you and tell you that you're going to lose everything sometimes in the midst of the night. None of you's ever been there before. Maybe you're too spiritual for that, but I've been there before. The devil come whisper in my ear and tell me, you know what, you've done too much wrong. You've made a mistake. Ahaz had made a major mistake, and the Syrians had already taken 200,000 men and women a few years before, but then God allowed them to be released back. And then also, not only that, he had killed 100,000 of his soldiers. So Ahaz, King Ahaz, when he's down in this valley, he's sitting down there, and he's going down by the water, the conduit, and he's going down to what they call the Fuller's Field. And he's down there to try to calculate, how can I keep my water supply right? By the way, you better keep the Spirit of God working in your life and the water of God watering your life, or we're all going to be in trouble. Some of us work out in the old world, and I did for years, and I still get, as I always said, there's one thing I don't want to do is work with the public. Now guess what I get to do? But you're working with the public, you better water your life with the grace of God and look into the Word of God and spend some time in prayer, because I'm telling you, people will test you. Tori, you know what I'm talking about over there. People, Chris, every once in a while, he gets out of line. I'm just giving him one of these, I'm telling you. I'm just kidding. He's perfect. He never does anything wrong. But I'm telling you, here's Ahaz, and he had already made a mistake, and Ahaz decided, like some of us maybe sitting in this room, Ahaz decided, you know what? I've made so many mistakes, and now the women and children have already been taken, and now these new people are coming up against me. Ahaz is thinking, you know what? He just decided God's way doesn't work anymore. I'm telling you, sometimes just because we have an experience, that doesn't mean that God's way doesn't work. Sometimes we need to keep pressing on and doing the right thing regardless. Sometimes I don't know what I really need to do, so I just keep doing what I know is right. I just keep doing what God told me last to do. But here's Ahaz. He decides to shut up the temple and said, we're going to shut down worship. We're not going to worship God anymore. And by the way, do you remember COVID-19? There's still churches that hadn't opened all the way back up. I talked to someone the other day, and they said, I've never returned to church after COVID-19. I'm not making fun at all. Some people that are in this church, their families have still not returned to a normal life because of the fear that the devil has put down inside of them. I'm not making fun of that, but I'm telling you, you don't think we was far from it? I still know people that are churches known of in California that were fined $30,000 per service because they went ahead and worshiped God through COVID-19, and the court battle's not over yet. So don't think we wasn't close to where Ahaz was. Ahaz said, you know what? I'm so fearful now. I'm not going to do it God's way. I'm just going to trust in the Assyrian God. But it got him in such a problem that he found himself attacked on every side. But God sent a message of grace by it. Don't you love it? That here's the message, is that he said, Isaiah, I want you to go down where he is. Now it's one thing to come to church and hear the message, but it's another thing to go out in the world and hear the message. But the message that we get here, that's why we put on the back of the door, church starts now. When you leave, that's when the message, we come here for corporate worship and to see people to know God and to find freedom, discover purpose and make a difference. But we got to go out in the highways and the byways and share the gospel with people. This was not friendship evangelism. Some of you don't know what that is, but several years ago, they started this deal. And I mean, I believe in making friends with people, okay? I like to have friends. I don't like making enemies. But this idea was you go out and you befriend them and you make good friends with them and you go eat with them and you go to small group with them. And then when you get their trust and you get their friendship, then you kind of slip the gospel into them. Listen, I'm not a big believer in friendship evangelism like that. I'm going to tell you something. There's people that are lost and they're on their way to a devil's hell. And what they need is someone to go to them and plead with them like Isaiah did. And say you're not living your life right. You need to change the way you're doing things. You need to repent of your sin. The message that Isaiah had for Ahaz wasn't. Some people get confused. They think, well, when you tell people about your sin, you're judging them. I'm not judging anything. I let the Word of God judge us. I just take the Word of God and open it up, and it says that he shall you continue in sin that grace may abound. God forbid. And that's what the Word of God says. And it says that he that knoweth to doeth good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. And so when we know to do the right thing in Isaiah, he goes down to the fuller's field, and the fuller's field was an interesting place. It was like a giant laundromat. Now, some of you like the laundromat, don't you? My mom would take us to the laundromat. And I mean, you talk about boredom. Jack, that's boredom. Mom would put them quarters in, and I don't know if she thought someone was going to steal the clothes or what, or didn't want to pay the gas money to get back home. But I'm like, Mom, can't we come back? Nope. We're sitting here at the laundromat. So you'd watch him dryer. Man, that thing liked to beat my head to death as a kid. We'd be trying to get inside of the ones that didn't work and stuff. Mom would yell at us. But just complete boredom. I mean, and she'd be waiting, and I'm like, Mom, put an extra few quarters in. You don't have to wait till it stops. But she was conservative. She'd check the clothes. You know what I'm talking about. Some of you have been down on hydraulic at the laundromat. You know what I'm talking about. Man, I'm telling you what. You'd watch the clothes going round and round. And that's what was happening. He says to Isaiah, God tells Isaiah, go down there amongst the laundromat, amongst the people, and start telling Ahaz about Jesus, that this son that is coming. And so Isaiah goes down there. Now, their laundromat was different. They didn't, I don't know if you knew this or not, but they didn't have electricity back then. So what they'd do is they'd get a flat rock and they'd cut grooves in that rock and they'd take them clothes and they used bleach and they used lye as bleach. And they'd lay them clothes out and they'd put that bleach down there and they'd stomp on them clothes like this with their feet and they would work their feet into them and it would wash. And down there in this field, there was really nothing living because there was a lot of clay down at the washer's field. But also that lye, nothing. Listen, my grandma believed in using bleach, amen? So mama, it clean you out. She didn't believe in a capful. But back then, hey, I went to get bleach the other day. It was $3 or $4. What in the world? I said, that used to be like, I'm talking about a couple years ago, 79 cents for a gallon. It has went up. I'm talking about, that's inflation. They said they had a shortage. I said, I'm bleach. What in the world? I can't even buy a hamburger. I'm buying bleach for the laundry. But they would use it generously. And down here in the Fuller's Field, they would use lye and they would use it generously. And what they would do is they would turn the clothes to white and then they would dye them with a different color. So here he is down, and that sounds like fun. I'd like to see it one time, but I wouldn't like to go down there and look at it for a long time. It'd be like a drawer, you know. I mean, and so Isaiah goes down there and he's got to give the message to the man of God, to Ahaz, and he speaks to Ahaz and he says to him, he says, look, here's the message. He said that if you do not have faith, you will not be established. Now, that seems like a simple message to it, doesn't Joseph? It seems like, well, that's pretty simple. But, you know, it's the simple things that confound the wise. Do you know what amazes me sometimes, Michael, how many people in life, they think they're just going to keep doing the same thing and get a different result? He says, what he's saying to him is, he says, look, you're fearful in heart and you're scared and you're mad at God. Hey, and by the way, the devil wants you to be mad at God. He wants you to be upset because of what happened in your life. But it ain't God's fault a lot of times what happens. Sometimes it's just life. The Bible says that he reigns on the just and the unjust alike. So sometimes things just happen. And so here he goes down to him and he says, look, if you do not keep your faith, then you shall not be established. What faith? He said, why don't you just ask for a sign? You know, some people, I don't mean this bad. We got a great looking, I appreciate all you guests today. Listen, I shout and spit on people all the time. It's not anything special, so don't feel bad about it. I still love you. But I always tell people, that's holy water right there, Carl. I'm telling you, that was holy right there. But I'm telling you. But the message was this. If you don't have faith, you'll not be established. Now, that sounds simple. But what's he saying? He's saying, Ahaz, I've got a message of grace for you. The prophet of God could have come and said, you loser, you're no good, you've shut up the temple, you've made mistakes, you had your people killed, and it's all your fault. But Isaiah went down and said this, if you do not have faith, you will not be established. What kind of faith was he talking about? Faith in Immanuel, the God that is with us. He said, Ahaz, if you'll make a decision to have faith, and Ahaz says, I won't even ask for a sign. And he said, I can't believe you would tempt the Lord thy God. But he said, here's what God's going to do anyway. You know, we don't even have to ask for it, and sometimes God shows up anyway. And sometimes in the mundanity of life, the most mundane things. Man, I've been working before. We worked in the oil fields, and we had, we called pull rods and pull tubing. What that means is just a whole lot of work. And man, we'd pull two rods up and we'd rinse the rods, break them, rinse the rods, go to the next one. Pull two rods up, break them, rinse the rods, go to the next one. Pull two rods, break them, rinse. And we'd do that 100 times, 140 times. Most wells around Wellington, around here, would have about 120 to 140 rods. They're about 3,400 feet to oil standing right where you're at right now, if there's oil here. And there has been oil around here, especially at 47th and Seneca down in there. There used to be a lot of wells. There's some over in the trailer park where you live at. Over there off a hydraulic, there's one in that park back behind your place, about 3,400 feet deep. And it seems so mundane. Because, I mean, I always said, you know, if we had enough bananas, we could teach someone to work on a pulling unit. You get that later. Some of you's monkey, you know what I'm saying. But you just had to have a lot of bananas to peel, to feed them, to get them to do the work all day long. But sometimes, in something that was so mundane and so normal, and so not fun, the sweet Spirit of God would whisper down on me. And he would tell me something that, you know what, child of God, I love you anyway. You know what, child of God, you may feel like you're going nowhere, but I've got somewhere for you to go. And sometimes it was in the mundanity of life. Listen, I love excitement and fireworks. I love the 4th of July, but it ain't the 4th of July every day. And that's what happened. Here the King Ahaz was, and he's saying, you got to have faith in this son. Do you know that devils tremble at the idea of Immanuel? If it was all about us, Keaton, then the devil would have nothing to worry about. But when you have faith in something that's bigger than you, something that's better than you, something that is purer than you, something that's holy and something that's right, and that there is a sacrifice that was made on a cross to this Immanuel, this God, with the devils tremble, people flee, spiritual things change shape when they realize that we have a faith in a God that is bigger, that is able to cover our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness and to give us, behold, old things, 2 Corinthians 5:17. Behold, old things are passed away. All things become new. And I believe his mercies are new every day. Amen. The faith in that God, faith is a substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Our faith has substance. This child that came into this world, he's saying, Ahaz, if you'll get it together and realize, he said, you will be established, but if you don't, your life is going to be ruined. Man, you would have thought, I always tell people, it's a whole lot better to fall into the hands of God than it is in the hands of men. Because this is the truth. Sometimes people will try you. And sometimes I say, God, I've had enough of them. Amen. No one in this church but other churches that I've been to. God, I've had enough of them. God, could you just deal with them? And man, I'm telling you what, I was thinking the other day about an individual. They're not here today, or I wouldn't be saying this. But I was thinking, God, why don't you just go down and smack them upside the head? You wouldn't pray. You wouldn't think that. But see, God's still working on me. I mean, in a good way. Don't knock their teeth out or nothing. But I'm talking about just get their attention, you know. That's redneck talk. I don't take that literally. This is being recorded. Trust me, I'm just joking. But I do. I say, God, go deal with them. God, why don't you just take care of it, God? Why don't you just stop this madness? By the way, I look at some of this government. I want the madness stopped. I want the lies and the cheating and the stealing. I just want to know what the truth is. I don't even care what the truth is, but I want to know what the truth is. And I said, you know, we got to be careful and watch this and watch that. And God reminded me, but where would you be? Where would I be if it wasn't for the Lord? Joe, Wanda, where would we be? And he reminds me of a place that I was down in the Fuller's Field and the mundanity of life, working on an oil rig in southern Kansas. And the sweet Holy Ghost of God paid me a visit and gave me a message of grace. And it wasn't because he told me that I was no good. It was because he told me he loved me anyway. And in the midst of that, that's where the Spirit of God spoke to me. And then here's what he tells Isaiah. He says, Isaiah, when you go down there, take your baby with you. Now listen. I don't even want to take my baby to the laundromat on South Hydraulic. I'm just being honest. I live down there, so don't think I'm making fun of you. I'm saying I live down there in Hayesville. I'm not far from it. But I want to take my child down there. But I definitely wouldn't want to take my baby down to a place where there's a king that's obstinate with God and there's people trying to destroy the city. But he says, Isaiah, you're going to have to show him that you care. See, people don't care what you know. They want to know that you care. I'd be in bad trouble if I had to build a ministry or, by the way, help be a part of this great church that I get to serve in. I'd be in bad trouble if I did it because of my mental capability. But I'll tell you what I do believe. I believe that God's given me the ability to care for people and deep where they're at. It doesn't matter where they're at. It doesn't matter where they've come from. It doesn't matter what race they are. It doesn't matter what they've been through in their past. And I think God's given this church and me an ability to be able to care and to be able to love people past where they are. And I'm telling you, you can clap. That's all right, because you guys are loving people. But he says, Isaiah, I want you to take your child with you. And on the way trip down to this, I begin to think about all this stuff, and I begin to think about how God began to deal with this situation. And, man, it was only God that could use it. But as he went down to this place, and Isaiah was making a trip down to Ahaz, where all this washing was going on and all this mundanity, At some point in time, when the king of Judah looked up, he had to have seen Isaiah coming, and he had that baby in his arms, and he would have said, "What is going on?" First of all, I didn't ask him to come down here. God asked him to come. Sometimes you ain't asking God for nothing, but God's got you covered. And he said, he sees Isaiah, Ahaz, King Ahaz is down there trying to figure out how he's going to, the city's not going to be defeated. And he sees this prophet of God with a baby in his arms. Now that's interesting. But if you think about it, he was trying to give him a picture of what was going to come. Now some of you don't understand it, but you'll understand this. Well, it's Christmas is coming up and I got grandbabies. Raise your hand if you got grandbabies in this room. You've lost your mind, every one of you. You let them grandkids get away with stuff them kids would never have done. Oh, it's okay. We just eat anywhere in the house. My son's like, "What, Dad? We don't eat in the living room on the furniture." I'll go, "We do now, son. These are the grandbabies. You know what I'm talking about? I mean, everything changes. Oh, it's okay. Let them tear the house down. We'll build a new one. Yeah, that's right. Sugar them up and send them home. No problem." But I'm telling you what, I'm excited about Christmas. Man, we've lost our minds. Amazon has a permanent route to our house every day for the next 2 weeks. If Tori was there, she'll tell you, we got boxes. You just walk through the center aisle of the door. I'm telling you, we're excited. Man, we didn't spend a lot, but they're big. We like to give them big stuff. It don't, if it's cheap and big, we buy it. Amen? This is a true story. We went to Branson, and thank you, church, for allowing us time to get away with my family. No work happened. It was kind of nice, and you know, that we were able to get away also last month. But man, I'm telling you what, this true story. With that car was so packed, I couldn't see out the rearview mirror. That's true. Well, I had to get myself a couple things too while I was there. Oh, yeah. Amen. But I'm serious. I'm not joking. The pack of the back of her car, it's got that back area. And we had that deal packed. I couldn't see nothing. And she got 10, I couldn't already see where I was going. But buddy, I knew how to get home. But I'm telling you, what I was so excited about is kind of like what the picture of what Isaiah, I know them grandbabies are going to open them little presents. And I know how it is. We're going to break the bank and probably some of it will have to pay off later, but there's grace for that too. But I know what's going to happen is, I remember one time my daughter was little and she opened up a box and there was a little baby in there. She picked up that baby and she held it. She said, "Oh, thank you, Daddy." Then that warms a daddy's heart and a grandpa's heart. And I know they're going to open all them presents and they're going to love them all and they're going to want to get to the next one. And you know, we've thought about having a more simple Christmas. We might do that one of these years, but I get excited. I'm like a kid myself. I'm always going to buy two or three gifts when I get to the store. I'm bad about wanting to bless them little grandkids and my kids. And I know they're going to open all that stuff and I'm going to look over and they're going to play at the box anyway. You know, I should have just went to Walmart and got a box and bought that, but wrapping up, they're going to be sliding around the box and I'm going to be like, "Hey, what about these toys?" You know, I know all that's going to happen. But it doesn't matter, because when they see that present, when they see that gift, it's going to remind them. And we're going to sit around with Luke chapter 2 and share the Christmas story and share about Jesus. And we're going to have a time of prayer. But the excitement that I have for that is nothing compared to the excitement that Isaiah is trying to tell Ahaz. He's saying, "Ahaz, I brought this baby with me." And it was symbolizing the baby that was to come. And I begin to think about them stripping those clothes and how they would have stripped that lie down there. And what they were doing is they was taking an old garment and they was making it new. The whole picture symbolism of what was happening down there is Isaiah said, "There's a baby coming, Ahaz." And he said, "All these garments and this mundanity, you see, these are being made new," and they would take dye and they'd put in the clothes. He said, "This is what's going to happen in your life if you will just give God the time of day." And then I begin to think about that child that's in his arms, how, you know, our faith should grow with us. I say this all the time. I've said it for years, and a few people have gotten it. But when I was a young boy, I was 10 years old, and I made a decision to serve God to the best of my ability. And you know, school was not my strength. But buddy, I'll tell you what, for sports, they kept me in there at least for sports for a little bit, and they had made enough grades to get through. But the preacher said to me, "Son, do you want to go to heaven or do you want to go to hell?" Well, I don't know too many people that will say, "I'll take hell today." So I said, "I'll take heaven." That's a good decision, and I said a prayer that went something like this: "God, please forgive me. Come into my life. Would you please save me?" Amen. The problem was, is my family got out of church a little bit after that. And through some events that happened in life, my faith never grew. So it wasn't a genuine faith. You see, a baby, you have to nurture it. This thing called Jesus, yes, he's the same God yesterday, today, and forever, but you've got to nurture your faith. There ought to come a time that, the Bible says that when I was a child, I thunk. That's not what it says, but that's the JB version. And when I was a child, I thunk as a child. But when I became an adult, I put away childish ways. When our kids are young, they mess their pants. Amen. And thank God for the people of this church that change your kids' diapers. You should get them something for Christmas. Because I put on a full hazmat suit when I got to do it. I'm just saying. But when I was a child, I expect them to mess on themselves. I expect them to make a mistake. But when we get older, we ought to know better than the things we fall into. That we ought to know those common sins that we fall into. Men, women alike, we all have those things the devil tries to. It's a trap. It's a snare. And what he tries to do is he tries to get you to go in for the things of the world instead of the things of God. But your faith has to grow. It has to nurture. If you ever watched a baby, I've been watching this baby this service, and I promise you that's exciting. But eventually that baby's going to get hungry. And it knows Papa's not the source. Amen? And Papa, I've held babies after they eat, but when it's time, they're looking for some eyes that look like mommy. Amen? They want nourishment. And that's the way we got to be like that little baby. And we got to be nurtured by God. We got to be brought along by God. We got to take him. It says, you know, the scripture says that behold, old things are passed away. All things become new. And that's what happens supernaturally. But we have to change our habits. We have to change the places we go. We got to change the friends we hang around. Our faith should nurture up into a way. And I'm telling you, I'm preaching to somebody, but I know for me, man, when I got right with God, everything changed. I was 29 years old, and you guys know my testimony probably better than I know it, but man, I remember it kind of got lonely a little bit. It did. I'm not going to lie. We had a great church. Boy, I served there 16 years, 15 years. My son married the pastor's daughter. We got three of them beautiful grandkids by then. We have eight all together. I mean, we got a big family. We were so excited, but it was hard because a lot of my friends would want to show up and do stuff I used to do. And I had to start saying, you know what? My faith is growing now. It's not like when I was a young man. I've got to put away childish ways. I got to change some things in my life. And I'm not saying I have no friends, but I had a whole lot less friends the 2 weeks after I made the decision. They'd show up and they'd say, have you lost your mind? What's wrong with you? You used to do this. You used to drink this. You used to do that. And I said, but that old man's dead. My faith's growing now. I can't partake anymore. Man, I'm telling you, it wasn't easy because I like to be friends with a lot of people. I don't think anybody, like I said, likes a lot of enemies. But it was kind of like that old garment that they'd take and they'd stomp it down in the ground. Sometimes God presses us. He's pressing our lives to get out something better. And that's the picture that Ahaz was getting. God's pressing us. God's using your enemies to push you to the Savior. And if you're not careful, you'll get resentful at God. You'll get mad at God. But he's pressing us. He's pushing us. He's driving the old stuff out of us. He's not doing it for our bad, but he's doing it because Romans chapter 8 says that all things work for the good for those who love God and who are called according to his purpose. These things in your life are going to work for good. But you got to have faith in the God, Immanuel. The God that is with us. And that faith will establish you. That faith, Terry Simmons, will put your feet on a solid rock. That faith will finally one day, Terry Simmons, I believe in you, buddy. I believe in you. Tell me the other day, don't give up. I ain't giving up on you. You wanna know why? Because God's never given up on me. One of these days, Terry Simmons, the things that you battle today, you're gonna look back and say, I'm not battling them anymore. I'm not fighting it. You're going to have different demons, different levels, different devils. But you're going to one day say, you know what? There was a day I had to pray past every liquor store in town. But there was a day that God delivered me and set my feet on a solid rock. And it's not that I don't have battles today, but I don't fight that battle anymore. Why? Because my faith is, I'm not where I need to be. But my faith's growing up a little bit. Some things are changing. Oh, we've had our battles, and there'll be battles tomorrow. But I don't focus on the battle. I focus on that little child Immanuel, God with us. That's the favor that God wants to give you. He wants to take you and put your feet on a solid rock. He wants to make you into where your testimony can behold, old things are passed away, all things become new. He wants to give you a new life in Christ. Every head bowed, every eye closed. I want to ask you this morning as they come and sing that maybe somebody here would say, you know, I've got some things I need changed. And, you know, I want to take on this faith and I need my faith to grow. I need to put faith in this Jesus. I need to put my faith in God, Immanuel, the God of the valley. Child of God, listen to me. You're here because you're in a valley. But God knew where you were and he sent this message to you. But maybe somebody here would say, you know, it's time for me to change and I want to be a part of this prayer. I'll pray for you. Sir, ma'am, I'll pray for you. Just slip up your hand and write back down. I'll pray for you. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, several of you. It's time, isn't it? It's time. God's talking to you. You feel it in your heart. You know that it's time. Thank you, sir. Anybody else that would say, you know, I want to be a part. Thank you. Thank you. Anybody else? Hands that were raised all over. And maybe you. Thank you, sir. Maybe you. Thank you, ma'am. Maybe somebody here would say, you know, life's kind of getting mundane and I know it's Christmas, but I don't feel it. You know what you need, sir, ma'am? What you need is to know that his mercies are new every day. Every day is another opportunity. If you have breath in your body, he's given you more grace and another chance. And maybe you need to say, you know what? I need to renew my faith. I need my faith to begin to grow again. If that's you, slip up your hand and write back down. I'll pray for you. Amen. Amen. A couple of you. A couple of you. Amen. If you raise your hand, even if you didn't, here's what I want you to do. This is the hard part. Your faith needs to have action. Your faith needs to take hold. There's a substance of your faith. And what you need to do right now, if you would, you don't have to, but I'm asking you, I'm pleading with you. If you raise your hand, just stand up right where you are. Don't wait, just stand up. Don't wait, stand up right where you are. Stand up, stand up, stand up, stand up. Now here's what I want to do. I want to pray with each and every one of you. So if you would just slip out of the chair, Christians in the attitude of prayer, slip back in your chair and I want to pray with you. As they begin to sing, why don't you come forward and we'll pray and ask God, if you would, why don't you come? Why don't you come? If you're standing, why don't you come?